dominant, overpowering. An automotive marvel driven to perfection. The Audi R8, sports car racing's dominant machine. Combining space-age materials and efficient aerodynamics, propelled by an outrageously powerful engine. With the instruments of the R8 orchestra played flawlessly by star international drivers, the music of victory has been unstoppable. Last year, Audi's pair of entries ran rings around the competition, winning 9 of 12 races in the American Le Mans Series, including the last 8 straight en route to a 1-2 championship finish. 2001 has opened in much the same way, with a win at Texas and a sweep of the top 4 spots at the 12 hours of Sebring. The Audi dominance creates an unusual rivalry. With no team orders, their drivers and cars race each other for the win as hard as the rest of the field. It's man against man, fighting to be the top gun. Today, sports car racing's road to Le Mans leads overseas to Donington, England, with all eyes on Audi's quest for victory. NBC Sports presents the American Le Mans Series. It's the 2001 season, and with the Great Le Mans Endurance Race drawing closer, competition has moved to Europe for the next 10 weeks. We're at Donington Park, England, about a 2-hour drive north of London, where Audi looks to extend its amazing streak of sports car dominance.
Hello from cloudy and cool Donington, England. Alan Bestwick here with Bill Adam as the American Le Mans Series returns to NBC. The history of sports car racing is filled with periods of one manufacturer dominating the other. It looks like we're expecting another dominant performance by Audi today.
I think it will happen, but this is something that we have to appreciate because it's like watching the best of the best. You see Tiger Woods, when he's at the best of his game, it's phenomenal. Or Michael Jordan, you just appreciate this level of excellence where they're kicking the whole game up to a new level.
But along with the strong Audis, we have a number of new and exciting things we'll see for the first time today.
And again, this goes with the level of excellence of this series. We have the great Saleen S7, beautiful brand new car. BMW has unveiled a V8 M3, a car with a lot of potential. And of course, Chrysler unveiled their new LMP, a gorgeous race car. Going very quickly, too.
All that coming up just moments when we drop the green flag. First, let's get some stories from pit lane. Here are Martin Haven and Calvin Fish.
We're racing in England, and what else would you expect but questionable weather? And the question is whether or not it will rain. And that may close up things at the front of the field, because the only time these Audis R8 have been beaten in a race is when it rained heavily at the Nürburgring in Germany last year. Now, have they learned from that, or will the others have a chance of winning overall? That remains to be seen. It will close up the racing in the prototype class if it rains, but close racing has never been a problem down in the GT class. Calvin Fish has more.
That's right, Martin. We have a titanic battle shaping up this year in the GT category between the German powerhouses of Porsche and BMW. Porsche won the first two events at Texas and Sebring, but it was at Texas that BMW unveiled their brand new Challenger. A new M3, but the kicker was no six-cylinder engine now, but a brand new 4-liter V8, and that has really ruffled the Porsche feathers. They feel that this car is not within the spirit of the regulations. Whatever the case may be, Frederik Ekblom used that power effectively yesterday to claim the pole position. All may not be lost for Porsche, however. When you have big power, that uses fuel. And here at Donington Park, with a 2-hour, 45-minute race, Porsche can get by with just one stop. BMW, unless they get a lot of caution period, will definitely need two. And that's going to cost them about 40 to 50 seconds getting in and out of the pits.
All right, Calvin, Martin, thank you. And let's talk about the weather just quickly for a second. We did have a rain shower maybe 30 minutes ago. The race was declared a wet race. All the teams put on their rain tires. Now it stopped raining, and that's going to throw the team's strategies into chaos at the start of the race. Donington Park is proving to be a very fun and interesting course for these sports cars. Bill Adam takes us for a tour around this 2.5-mile track.
Donington Park is a magical name in the world of motor racing. 2.4 miles winding through the English countryside, and what a ride it gives us. We're on board the Alex Joe Porsche as we come down the front straight here. Can we get up into sixth gear over 135 miles an hour? And watch up ahead, because late braking and cars will always be doing that, sliding up the inside.
This is Redgate Corner, a corner that you think goes away, but it just keeps going. We're going to go downhill through the Craner curves here. This increases your speed dramatically, 135 miles an hour. Again, you're back up into sixth gear, and we'll try and pass this Porsche right here at the old hairpin. Now duck inside, but watch for contact. Your race could be over if you meet somebody right there. Hard on the throttle, we'll get again back up into sixth gear. This track gives the box a real workout. We're looking up ahead to the Schwanz corner and eventually to McLean. A third gear corner all the way down about 70 miles an hour. You jump on the throttle and try and catch as much speed up here as you can. Up ahead is a blind long coppice corner. A double apex turn, the car starts to slide out. You've got to bring it back into the second and accelerate hard down this long straight out of the Dunlop Bridge. A good spot for passing up ahead because we're gonna drop from 144 miles an hour all the way down to about 45. Over the curbs there, back to the inside, and on that gas hard. You want to carry as much speed down the straight as you can. We're heading towards the Melbourne Hairpin, a famous part of the track. You want to get in deep as you can at a late apex. Feeding on power gently here, not getting the car sideways, but trying to get as much speed back up ahead because one more hairpin faces us. This is Goddard's hairpin, a hairpin that takes us back out onto the front straight. You carry as much acceleration as you can. Fight the oversteer because this is an exciting lap at Donington Park.
Like I said, a very interesting and challenging course for the drivers. Four classes of cars competing in today's race in the American Le Mans Series. The LMP900s, the purpose-built prototypes, got to weigh a minimum of 900 kilograms. They're rockets on wheels. New for this year, the 675, basically smaller versions of the prototype cars. GTS and GT, the production-based machines, the bigger displacement, more thoroughbred racing machines, the GTS cars, the GT, the closer to stock racing cars. And now let's take a look at our Audi starting grid for today's race here at Donington Park, England. Tom Christensen put the car on the pole, the Audi R8 continuing its dominant run in qualifying. On the outside of the front row, their teammate Frank Bila qualified that car. He'll start from the second position. In row two, it is Stefan Johansson in the customer Audi car. He crashed that at the end of qualifying yesterday. More on that in a minute. And the debut of the Chrysler prototype in racing with Olivier Beretta to start outside of row two. The Peugeot Courage from the Pescarolo team from France starts in fifth position. In sixth, it'll be an Ascari. New look for us, we haven't seen this car in the States much. Werner Lupberger to start that machine on the outside of row three. The Peugeot team struggled in qualifying. Jan Magnussen back in seventh position. It is the customer Peugeot car, last year's model, with Jay Cochran starting in eighth. Then the second of the Peugeot factory machines in ninth position, with Walter Salles to start that machine. Rounding out the top 10, one of the LMP 675 cars. This is a Nissan-powered machine with Martin O'Connell to start in the 10th position. Our GTS pole sitter is in the 11th spot overall. It's Oliver Gavin in the sleek Saleen S7R. And the GT pole sitter is starting back in 14th position overall. One of those controversial BMW M3s with Frederick Ekblom qualified the car to starting. And the rest of the starting field, among the notables here, is the 12th starter. That is a brand new LMP 675 car from Dick Barber Racing. We'll tell you a little bit more about later in our broadcast. And the very last car in the field is the second of the BMW Works GT cars. They broke the engine warming it up before qualifying. JJ Leto has to start last. He'll be fun to watch come up through the field. Getting set to go. Got some wonderful onboard looks for you today during our coverage. This is Stefan Johansson in that now repaired Audi R8. He starts in third position. Stuffed the nose of it into the barriers on his cooldown lap after qualifying yesterday. We talked about the BMW and JJ Leto starting last in the field. We'll ride on board with him as he tries to cut through traffic and catch his teammate and the Porsches for the GT class win. Speaking of Porsche, here's the Alex Job Racing Machine, the 23 car with Lucas Lohr starting. See third in class and 16th overall. And we'll also have a camera on board the pole sitting Audi R8 with Tom Christensen on board that machine. He will lead the field to the green flag just seconds from now. Field making its way around on its final parade and pace lap as we get set to go. This is a timed race. First one to get to the distance at the end of the scheduled time scores the victory. Cold racetrack
damp racetrack. They're on rain tires, Bill. What are the drivers thinking as they get set for the start?
They're thinking that they would rather be someplace else right now because a lot of them have gone to a soft setup, which is what you want for the rain. Now, the cars are on slick tires, but there has been some gambling. The brakes are going to be stone cold. They have to be careful. They're going to get a green and they're off.
Out Bila on the break into Redgate corner to take the lead. Here's Johansson up the inside with a bid for second.
Stefan Johansson has got a lot of incentive for this particular race because the Gulf colors are magic here in England. So many years, John Wire ran the famous Gulf Porsche team, having victories at Le Mans with Porsches and with Ford GT40s, actually. But this car has got to be the sentimental favorite today.
So Johansson and the customer Audi splits the two factory entries into the first couple of corners on lap one. Let's go back and reiterate, the race was declared a wet race initially, but apparently with the track drying out, all the teams were allowed to change back to slick tires on the grid. Calvin Fish can give us more on that. Calvin?
Well, it seems, guys, that no one really started the race on wet weather tires. In fact, Audi had the option of going to a softer compound because once the race is declared wet, they can change to any tire they want, but they feel it really unbalances the race car to do that at this stage of the game. So I believe the majority of the field is on slick weather tires. However, if it does turn to rain, remember, the only time the RA has been beaten was at the ring last year in torrential downpours. Since that time, Audi has done extensive testing with Michelin. Michelin arrive here with two brand new wet weather tires.
Yeah, part of the problem at the ring, the Audi was beaten there last year, is that they really had done little to no testing beforehand. Very, very untypical, but they were more interested in perfecting the car in other areas. Now, as Calvin pointed out, they have done a lot of testing since then, and to look back at Mosport last year, a race that was run a lot in the rain, they were blindingly fast, so I don't think it's something that really worries them.
Data box upper left of your screen will show you the running order throughout our coverage of this Donington Park round of the American Le Mans Series. That is Tom Christensen, the new hot star driver in sports car racing that we'll meet in just a short while. Christensen on board the pole-sitting Audi R8. You see he's opened up about a, 7, 8, 10 car length lead on Stefan Johansson. Now let's talk about the Johansson machine just for a moment. After he took the checkered flag at the conclusion of qualifying Friday afternoon, he got off the track on his cooldown lap and stuffed the nose of that into the barriers. They worked late last night to fix that car, but obviously they've done well.
And I think this also speaks to the overall program of Audi. They come so prepared. We saw this at Le Mans last year where they changed the entire rear end of the car in just a few minutes. It's the total piece, which normally is an hour, a couple of hour long job, just a massive job. They think of every single detail. And this is one of the things that they know if something does happen, what they have to bring, what they need. And they were totally prepared for it. So it looks like he's up to speed because he's staying comfortably ahead of the other Yost car.
Let's take a look at what happened yesterday, the crash we were just describing with Stefan Johansson in that number 7 Audi. He's taken the checkered flag. He's going through the first and second corners, and watch this.
Yeah, look, he's only got a couple of wheels in the grass, but he can't get off the grass, and suddenly, bam! That was a hard hit.
And you know right about there, he was just kicking himself. He'd taken the checkered flag.
Yeah, been there, crashed that. I know what that feels like.
Do you really? That sounds like a story over dinner sometime. So Johansson runs in second, splitting the two factory Audis as we ride on board with him. He almost did it again.
Jeez,
right there.
Yeah, he got right to the edge of the road right there. Part of the difficulty right now with this cold weather is to get the tires up to temperature quickly. You want to try and push as hard as you can, like Christensen is doing up ahead, but you have to be so careful. All weekend long, a number of teams have been having problems getting front tires up to temp. Pano's particularly, they have just had nightmare stories, both with front tires and front brakes. This cold air funnels into air ducts that normally are built for maximum efficiency. Here, a lot of the teams have actually taped the ducts down to reduce the airflow coming in, thereby keeping the brake temperature up, so we'll have solid brake pedals when they need it.
Temperature only in the upper 40s here at Donington Park today. Rain is a possibility. A couple of interesting wrinkles to keep an eye on as we cruise throughout our coverage. It's the American Le Mans Series on NBC. Audi leads. We're just underway.
Is brought to you by BMW, the ultimate driving machine. Visit your local BMW center today.
Oh. best in sports car racing returns to North America July 22nd when the American Le Mans Series Stars and Cars battled it out at the X Factor Grand Prix of Sonoma at California's Sears Point Raceway. Don't miss this chance to see Le Mans in America. Get your tickets now by calling 1-800-870-7223.
Of the American Le Mans Series for 2001 is at Donington Park in Castle Donington, England. We are just underway. The leader is the silver car with the yellow spoilers slashing through slower traffic. Tom Christensen and the Audi R8 started on pole, held the lead into turn one, and has opened up about a 2 second, now it's a 3 second advantage on Stefan Johansson, who runs in second place. GT standings, championship wise, coming into the race, the BMW GT class points, Sascha Mawson, Porsche driver, along with his teammate Lucas Luhr holding down the first two spots. Randy Pulst and Christian Menzel, also Porsche drivers, in third position. Then Borisette and Hans Stuck, who are BMW drivers, are in the fifth positions. Among the missing in that graphic are the Star Factory BMW drivers, who are on track here today.
And there is the star right there. That is the number 42 car that started at the back of the pack. And he's literally flying through the pack right now. He's just having great fun, dicing, cutting, flying around the track. He's able to use all of the horsepower this new controversial 4-liter motor is putting out. And the Porsche guys are very upset about this engine. We're gonna get a look here, just what he's seeing. Now that's the Porsche following. This is an incredibly fast car. Watch this coming off the corner. A little smoke right there. Hopefully that ends in engine smoke, maybe just brake smoke. He's exiting down. Now he's heading down towards Melbourne here, I believe.
Yep.
You're going to see him go over the crest of a little hill. Now he's steeply downhill. See the Porsche close up under braking, turning in. Watch the G-force on the bottom. You can see over one and the acceleration, 80, 90, 100. Very quick car. There's JJ at work.
Oh, trouble.
Panos. It looks like he's only hit a sign, though.
That's the customer, Panos.
Yeah,
had a spin.
I think the car is perfect. He might just have come into contact with one of the braking markers and just shredded it.
That's Jake Cochran, who has got it back running. Have a look at it here and see what happened. Up, got off the track to his left.
On the curb, sliding in. Oh, boy.
Ooh.
Breakaway signs.
I hope nobody was planning on using that 200 marker as a breakpoint.
The British version of an airbag.
Yeah, there you go. Cochran is back on track. Not apparently the worst for wear. He has fallen to the eighth position overall in that 2000 model Panos car.
Remember, Jay Cochran from years ago gave Ferrari the 333 its first ever win in North America. He won the race at Road Atlanta with that car, so Jay has a good experience with these LMP cars.
Here's your GT class leader. This is the team car, the BMW M3. That's Frederik Ekblom on board. First in GT, 14th overall, as you see there.
Now, just to explain more about why the Porsche drivers are so upset about this car, they're saying that you can't buy an M3 with a V8, which is correct. Nor can you buy any BMW with this particular V8. This is a custom-built full race motor. It's a beautiful piece of work.
Looked at
one in the pits, and it was very tiny.
Yeah. Looking at the interval there from first back to second in class, 23 cars, Lucas Luhr being overtaken by the overall race leader, Tom Christensen. The yellow Porsche there, the bottom yellow. That's Luhr, the German driver.
And I think Luhr is probably doing something smart right now. He knows he doesn't have to race with the BMW under the dry conditions where they're able to use all the horsepower. They will use up more fuel. All Lucas really wants to do is to keep that car in sight, either closing up under a pace car situation, which is always a possibility, although unlikely here in England. We have great runoff areas. Or the other thing is that they just simply have to make more pit stops because they have to feed the horses.
Let's talk about when we talked about the point graphic earlier, why the factory BMW drivers weren't there. Because they're developing a new car, they've had to take some time at the beginning part of the season, and they've had a couple of hiccups.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And the PTG team that we usually see, Tom Milner's team, their drivers too will have this new version of the M3 very, very shortly. So they're building them as quickly as they can. But it takes a long time to develop any race car.
Lucas Luhr, second in GT, 15th overall, running right behind the BMW of Frederik Ekblom. Top of the stack, it's Tom Christensen of the Audi R8, who's turning lap times just 1 second off his pole-winning qualifying speed here at Donington.
I remember 20 years ago, Audi turned the racing world upside down. First by introducing a race car with quattro all-wheel drive, and second, by having a woman drive it.
Hi, I'm Bob.
And I'm Charlie.
This lawn is a work of art. I use Scott Premium Grass Seed. Deer and Fear brands have weeds, but the seed that Scott has is the purest seed you can get. Healthy, lush, green. The lawn is only as good as the seed you start with.
How can you keep track of the latest in sports car racing? Monthly with Le Mans and Sports Car Racer magazine. New from the publishers of F1 Racing and Autosport. Call 1-800-800-3921 to subscribe. It's the fastest way to keep track.
The past, an epic playoff battle that went the distance. The present, a final regular season encounter. And as the playoffs loom large, will a rematch be in their future? The Blazers take on the Lakers to cap an NBA tripleheader Sunday on NBC.
Tonight at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, the XFL postseason kicks off on NBC. One win separates the Orlando Rage and the San Francisco Demons from a shot at the million-dollar game. Can the Rage continue their regular season dominance in the playoffs? Or will the Demons' stingy defense be too much for Orlando to handle? It's the XFL playoffs tonight, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, on NBC. Donington Park, England. And the American Le Mans Series coming your way today on NBC Sports. You're riding with Tom Christensen, the race leader in the Audi R8. Started on pole. He's led every lap so far. He has been tough. He is out in front of second place by 7.1 seconds at this point. Second place has changed hands. It is now his teammate Frank Bila, who has passed Stefan Johansson in the customer Audi R8. As we look at the interval back, there's Christensen leaving the frame top. Here's second and third down the bottom. Now, the pass for second was quite breathtaking. Here's how it happened a minute ago while we were in the break.
Well, it really was. I think that the Gulf car tries to go inside here. It is way, way too tight. Has to get off the power. And look what this does for Bila. Bila takes a bit of a risky move, slides up right on the edge of the road. You saw a little bit of dust getting kicked up on the tires. But he was able to get under boost earlier than the Gulf car and makes a nice, clean pass on him.
So Bila to second, Johansson back to third. Again, those two drivers about 7 seconds behind Tom Christensen. Let's get updates from pit road. Here's Calvin Fish.
Well, Didier Deradicus is in here with a Barber Racing entry, the LMP 675. He said that he had an overheating problem and a vibration. He's been in twice now. They looked at the engine. Everything seemed okay. Now they're going to the rear tires and changing those in case that's the vibration problem. And an update on Cochran in that Panos, last year's car. We saw him spin earlier or go off track. He's having major handling difficulties. He's been into the pits. He adjusted the rear wing. He's got high speed understeer and no traction off the slow stuff, so they adjusted the rear tire pressures on that car. And I believe Martin Havens has an update on the BMW camp.
Well, BMW's new 4-litre V8 motor, not a production engine, a purebred racing engine, caused problems to JJ Leto and Jörg Müller's car in qualifying when they couldn't start it officially. And now in the race, the 43 sister car has struck a misfiring problem. It came in with only 5 cylinders of the 8 running cleanly, but they don't think it's a metal problem. They think it's an electricity problem. They're changing spark plugs, spark plug leads, spark boxes, in fact, anything that'll give you a nasty shock in the hope that they will get the car back in. And the clue is that A, Schnitzer never gives up, and B, Fredrik Ekblom hasn't even got out of the cockpit.
Well, it could be worse. We're in England, and you know how English electrics are.
I'm just not going there. I haven't had any problem with it so far. This is his teammate, JJ Leto, who has also had problems. We saw Leto charging up through the field after the engine problem that kept him from qualifying started last, had moved up in 12 laps to within 3 seconds of the Porsche that is now leading the class, but then had to come down pit road.
Apparently it passed under yellow flag, which is a caution flag, really. You want to take extra caution around the yellow flags. He apparently did the pass. We did not see it, but the officials wisely pulled him in, and you saw him throw up his hands in frustration.
Now Lato is back on track, but he has fallen a good ways behind, 3.69, 18 seconds behind the leading Porsche in the GT class. And we go back up now to the lead car, Tom Christensen in the Audi R8. This team we've talked about already in the broadcast, their dominance. They gave up a championship driver at the end of last season, Alan McNish, who was the American Le Mans Series champion, moved on to become a testing driver for Toyota's Formula One team. So how do you replace a champion? Well, you hire Tom Christensen, who's considered right now the hot rising star of sports car racing. Let's spend a minute meeting him. Tom Christensen is a 33-year-old from a small town of 13,000 in northern Denmark, an area not normally known for producing world-class race drivers. Christensen says his fierce driving style that's now attracting international recognition is described quite simply.
Determined, very determined, and very aggressive inside the car, but people keep calling me as a smooth driver. But I don't feel like that in the car. I feel I'm aggressive. Obviously, I try not to stress the car too much, losing time with too much wheel spin and things like that. But I would say determined. They call me the seeker.
Away from the track, Christensen takes a little different route to staying in shape than many drivers, shunning long hours in the workout room for outdoors activity of all kinds.
You have to keep fit driving these cars, otherwise it's going to bite you. So I like mountain biking, and I like jet ski in the summer. I just like these things are my favorite. I like skiing as well. I like to play squash at wintertime. I don't like gym so much, so I think I have to try a lot of the other, do some more of the other exercises.
Getting a full-time ride with the powerful Audi team brings a fair amount of pressure, but replacing the series champion adds another whole set of expectations. Christensen doesn't seem fazed by it, though.
I was a little bit with the team last year. Obviously, we won Sebring, we won at Le Mans, so I knew when I come and be a part of the team that it will be more natural being with the people all the time. And that will bring more speed out of me.
I don't think there's any question that last year Alan McNish was the fastest of the Audi drivers. And I don't think there's any question three races in this year, Tom Christensen is the fastest of the Audi drivers.
He's a lot of fun to watch, too. He's very reminiscent of Alan's style in so many ways, and his precision is really remarkable. You watch him. He is so consistent, lap after lap after lap, having the car slide right to the same point near the edge of the road. I mean, just really great to watch and learn from.
Tom Christensen leading round three of the American Le Mans Series for 2001 in Castle Donington, England. Here's our leaderboard. There's the BMW coming back out to give it another shot. There are the leaders. We'll be back in a minute.
Dad, I missed the bus.
Really?
The 911 Carrera. What only a Porsche brings to driving.
Thanks, Dad.
Dad.
Chateau Elan Hotels and Resorts, the subtle difference of excellence.
Hi, I'm Renee Zellweger, and I'm hosting Saturday Night Live with musical guest Eve. Watch, and I'll show you the funny. Do we have better writers for the actual show?
The American Le Mans Series on NBC from Donington Park in Castle Donington, England, about a two-hour drive north of London. You're looking at the race leader and the driver who has led every lap so far, Tom Christensen. In the Audi R8, he's 7.4 seconds up on his team car of Frank Bielo, but he had a close call a minute ago, a close call kind of his own making.
It really was of his own making, too. He was following one of the LM 675 cars. Right here we see it. A car that is equally as fast at this point in the track. Suddenly, he decides to go up the inside and look at the contact. He is lucky he did not tear a winglet off the nose of the car, but the 675 car, O'Connell's car, spins around and loses a little bit of time.
But Martin O'Connell able to get it fired up and continue on away without any significant damage, but that was a way you could throw a whole race away if you're the dominant car like Christensen.
Well, maybe it was the kiss of death because we had talked about Tom Christensen as being such a perfect driver.
Yeah.
There he made a pass that he really didn't need to make. There are some points on the track where you lose tremendous amounts of time if you follow a car through them. You have to take a bit of a chance to get by them, but that was not one.
Looking back from the lead car to the 21 machine that he had that incident with a minute ago. There he is. Now this is one of the LMP 675 cars. They are lighter, they have less horsepower than the prototypes, but they are still, as you can see, the purpose-built racing rockets, and they are sporty little things.
Yeah, these are beautiful little race cars. This one here is called a Pillbeam, which is designed and built by a fairly local English manufacturer, race car manufacturer. And it has a 3-liter normally aspirated Nissan motor. Puts out something just over 400 horsepower, but it is running very quickly. And this particular car is extremely well driven. It is battling up against Dick Barber entry today, the Reynard Judd, of course, which has substantially more horsepower. But these guys are making really good use of local track knowledge and stunned everybody in qualifying by grabbing the pole for the 675 class.
There's Frank Bila. And the other of the Audi R8s, I say the other, there are three of them in the race, two factory cars and one privateer car. Let's go back to the Christensen thing for a minute when he punted O'Connell off. Rough driving, contact between cars is a rarity in this form of sport, but it became a big issue last year in the middle of the summer. There got to be a lot of incidents between the fast prototype cars and the slower class cars getting punted off the track by the quicker cars.
It's very difficult. As races wear on, I think driver fatigue sets in. You lose a little bit of concentration. And these drivers, like for example in the Celine S7 here, they're having their own battle. They're trying to go as quickly as possible. You don't always have the luxury of taking a glance in your mirror to see if somebody's trying a high-risk pass up the inside. So contact is going to take place, but it is not a normal part of sports car racing like it is for NASCAR, for example. NASCAR, you give somebody a little bump in the corner.
This is the Celine S7, which is leading the GT class right now. It's Ian McKellar who is in the lead. The other of the Celine cars just made a pit stop a minute ago, the Franz Conrad racing machine. And let's go to Calvin Fish, who's with the driver who just vacated that car.
Well, the Celine has certainly been the sensation in GTS this year. Oliver Gavin won at Sebring, beating the Corvettes. They're not here, Ollie, but seems like he stopped a little bit early.
Yeah, we've got a problem with the rear of the car. I'm not entirely sure what it is, but the boys had a look at it, and Franz has now gone out, and he's going to try it, see how we go. But the car is oversteering hugely at the moment, which we've never, ever had with this car, so maybe there's a problem. So
you had an upright problem earlier in the weekend. Did you fix that?
Yeah, we thought we'd fix that. We don't think that's the problem now. Maybe a differential problem or something, but we're not sure. But Franz is driving now. He's going to make an assessment on it, and then we'll see how we go.
Conditions right now, it's drizzling. Do you need to stay on slicks, or will people be looking at intermediates?
No, I think slicks still. It's not raining hard enough. It's so, so cold here. It's just getting the heat into the tyres is the problem. But I think slicks for the minute, and then go from there.
Thanks, mate.
All right.
Franz Conrad has gotten aboard that Celine, and we've had a pit stop. Tom Christensen was on pit road in the lead Audi while we were talking to Gavin, so now he's back in third place. Frank Bielo is the leader. Stefan Johansson there in the 7 car is in second for the moment.
Golf car coming in.
Now he comes to pit road.
Also saw Christensen get a little sideways off the hairpin there, showing that maybe it is getting slicker.
And I say Christensen, I believe Dindo Capello has gotten on board that lead Audi. We'll follow up on that in just a second. In the meantime, here is Johansson on pit road. Refresher, if you're not familiar with Le Mans rules, you cannot change tires or do anything else on the car while it's being fueled. Let's go to Calvin.
Stefan, you stay in the car. No driver change right now. A lot of the teams were suggesting if they had to go to intermediate tires, then they'd do the driver change at the same time. As Alan was then discussing and Bill, is essentially if you're doing a tire change, you need to get that driver change during that stop so you don't waste time if you're not changing tires. So the conditions are just staying
Right, cool right now. Stefan's going to stay in the car. Fueling is done. And now they're actually going to the rear tires. This is a surprise. We did not expect a tire change. They're putting rears on. They're going to the fronts, taking the lug nuts off there. So it looks like a four-tire change, staying on slicks for Johansson in the Golf machine.
Stall it. No, gotta go. Those, the flashing light in the dashboard, by the way, that is not showing anything's wrong with the car. That shows his pit speed limiter was engaged. It's just a little reminder for the drivers. He has a button on the steering wheel that will keep him to the speed limit that is mandated down every pit lane. Has to release that as he exits the track, gets back up to full power once more. Oh, and there's somebody slowing down. That's a dangerous place to stop.
Here's Tom Christensen in the pits. Stop a minute ago earlier.
Ah.
So apparently he'd not come in the pits, but he fell from first back to third, and he's very agitated.
He's angry, yeah. Look at the hand motion.
Let's go to Martin Haven. Martin. Get an update from Martin in just a moment as he's down in the Audi pit. Getting an update on what's going on there that's gotten Christensen so agitated. He heads back out onto the racetrack. So what is normally smooth as silk operation for the Audi team apparently is they've gotten their feathers ruffled about something, and we'll have to find out what it is here in just a moment. Meantime, let's take a break. It is Frank Bila and Tom Christensen who are the top two here in Donington.
Tuesday starts with an all-new Fighting Fitzgeralds and the return of Third Rock with only 5 episodes left till the grand finale.
I promised I wouldn't do this.
Will the aliens reveal their true form? Then, on an all-new Frasier.
Show me your exercise mat now.
Dad gets a new therapist.
She did things to me. Bad things.
All-new comedy, NBC Tuesday.
The American Le Mans Series, round 3 of the 2001 campaign from Donington Park in central England. Tom Christensen is the race leader, and now that we had the opportunity, the commercial break, to do a little investigating, we find out why he was so agitated on that pit stop a minute ago. He did make two pit stops. I said he made a pit stop, then I said, well, no, he hadn't. Well, he did make two pit stops. The first one was for a penalty. Remember when we showed him punting the little Nissan LMP675 car off the track? Well, he got penalized for rough driving. That was the first pit stop, and that's why he was so agitated, but he came down for a scheduled stop.
It can be very frustrating. Sometimes you think you're doing everything right, but it's easy to lose perspective. And what did the drivers of the top cars have to keep in mind is that these other classes, they're all running their own races. And particularly at that point in the track, again, I want to stress, the little car is just as quick as the Audi. These little 675 cars go through the high-speed S's with tremendous speed. Christensen did not have to pass, but it almost becomes human nature. These Audis are steamrollers.
Second place, 52 seconds behind Christensen, is Stefan Johansson in the customer Audi car, the Gulf-sponsored machine. There it is, blue and orange, coming into the frame. Got a little spin off track behind him there. It's the 69 car, one of the Porsches. That's Kai Wankum, the Canadian driver, who's behind the wheel of that one. GT car spun off, but is driven back on. There's Stefan Johansson. Remember, we saw him on pit road a minute ago, took the surprise tire change, but did stay on board the car. This car rebuilt after a crash at the conclusion of qualifying yesterday. Now, third place is the other of the factory Audi R8s. It's now being driven by Emanuele Pirro. That car on pit road a moment ago and lost an awful lot of time. It's one lap down to the race leader and 44 seconds behind second place because of a problem they encountered on the racetrack. Calvin Fish has more on what happened to the now third place Audi.
Just made their schedule stop, and then Frank Bila got into it with some traffic out there as well. This time he wasn't as fortunate, and it really damaged the right side of the car. A little bit of bodywork damage, but more importantly, it punched the right rear tire. So when he came in, they then took advantage of that pit stop situation to do the driver change, Bila getting out, Pirro back into the car. As far as we know, the team is reporting that no problems with the car's handling, so it was just a flat tire. Martin Havens has a report on the Chrysler story today.
more from Martin in just a minute. That video on the Audi pit stop a little earlier. Back to live action now as Pirro on board the car. Again, 44 seconds behind second place and a full lap behind his team car, the race leader, Tom Christensen.
And kind of interesting, too, that we heard that that number two Audi came in contact with none other than the 21 LM 675 car, the same car that Christensen hit.
The GT leader is on pit road. Let's go to Calvin.
Lucas Lehr brings the GT Porsche into the pits, and this is perfect for the Porsche team. We talked about it at the front end of the show. If they get to about the halfway point, they can do this on one stop, and that's the way they're looking. BMWs are struggling here a bit today, so this looks like it's going to be another inter-team rivalry battle here between Lucas Lehr, Sascha Maassen, and Randy Post and Christian Menzel in the other Alex Job Porsche.
Sascha Maassen getting on board that car as Lucas Lehr gets out. There's Maassen. Now that they're done with the fueling, they can start the work on the tire chain. Sascha Maassen, 31 years old, from Germany, is all of 1 point up on his teammate Lucas in the GT Driver Championship coming into this race.
What a luxury to have a team with all four drivers being so highly qualified.
Yeah. Waiting for the crew to finish work so they can start the car. You have to shut the car off during the fueling. And now he's off and on his way. 60 kilometers per hour, the speed limit. That's about 37 and a half miles an hour. And off he goes, back out on track. We talked at the top of the show about some of the new and different things we were going to get the chance to see here in today's race, besides the dominant Audis. One of those new and different things, the debut of the Chrysler prototype effort. Remember, Chrysler so dominant in GTS with their Vipers the last few years. Now going to the prototype machine, and let's get an update on their race for Martin Haven.
Well, this car was lying a strong fourth place after practice, and they were holding that position in the race despite the fact that starting driver Olivier Beretta had a sticking throttle. They came in for their first scheduled pit stop, and they lost three laps, putting a new throttle return spring on to allow Yannick Damas, who took over the car, to drive with some confidence. Now, whether it's confidence on his part or somebody else's, I don't know yet, because the car has just arrived unexpectedly in the pits. And as you can see, they are taping up damage on the left-hand side. Now, Olivier Beretta is standing right with me. Olivier, do you know what happened to Yannick?
No, I don't know.
So we'll have to dig into that a little better, but that looks like another lap going down for the Mopar engine car. One note of interest, though, this is the longest this car has ever run to date.
Yeah, they said they've never run the car more than an hour without having to stop at all the testing that's been done on it. So that's part of the reason why this car is here today. The target for Chrysler with this machine to run in the Le Mans 24-hour race in June. This the first race that it has ever made, and a good almost 3-hour test of what to expect.
It really is. It's a very impressive car. It's beautifully finished off. Originally was a Dallara chassis, a car that's better known for building formula cars, but their craftsmanship, the quality of the build on it is beautiful. What they've adapted is an aluminum 6-liter motor that, to go way back, was a drag race motor. Then it was used for sprint cars and so on. Now they've refined it into a road racing engine, and they're working to make this a world beater. It's spectacular. You can see right there how the fender has a very deep groove in it. This is all air evacuation. They spent a lot of time in the wind tunnel with it. Apparently, it is very low drag and very high downforce. And it was impressive seeing the car up in fourth place for such a long time today.
The car fielded for Chrysler by the French-based Oreca team that has had so much success fielding the Viper effort for Chrysler over the last few years. Two-time defending American Le Mans Series champions in the GTS class, and now they've moved to the open top racing. Yannick Damas behind the wheel, a four-time Le Mans winner, and going to go after number five with the Chrysler effort in the middle of June. Back to our leader, Tom Christensen, who's still on board this car, has not yet yielded to his team driver, Dindo Capello. Christensen coming back from the stop-and-go penalty to reassume the lead by 54 seconds over Stefan Johansson. You're watching the American Le Mans Series on NBC.
If a car company puts a little sports car in everything it builds, imagine what happens when it builds a sports car.
Zoom, zoom.
Zoom, zoom, zoom. Zoom, zoom, zoom. Yeah, zoom, 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 zoom.
Introducing the new Mazda Miata. 6 speeds, VVT engine, even more fun.
Yeah, 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 zoom.
The company that reinvented the Roadster keeps reinventing the Roadster.
The world's best
latest in sports car racing returns to North America July 22nd when the American Le Mans Series Stars and Cars battled it out at the X Factor Grand Prix of Sonoma at California's Sears Point Raceway. Don't miss this chance to see Le Mans in America. Get your tickets now by calling 1-800-870-7223. The 127th running of the Kentucky Derby, the first Saturday in May, as the Visa Triple Crown begins on NBC.
Welcome back to the American Le Mans Series on NBC from Donington Park in Castle Donington, England. Tomorrow at noon Eastern, don't miss an action-packed NBA tripleheader, each game having playoff implications. First up, the Knicks from Latrell Sprewell take on Allen Iverson of the top team in the East, the 76ers. The Jazz and the Timberwolves battle it out with their postseason positions on the line in the West. And to cap it off, the Blazers take on the Lakers in a possible playoff preview. It's tomorrow at 12 noon Eastern, the NBA on NBC. Tom Christensen in the Audi R8 leading. He's led most of the distance to this point, except for when he got a penalty for bumping another car off the track and then made his scheduled pit stop. He quickly got back up front when the other cars made their pit stops and has dominated this race so far. Now, the GTS category, these are the production-based cars with the bigger engine displacements and a little more racy feel to them, if you will. This is the Celine that is leading the GTS category. Bruno Lambert driving in ninth position overall.
It's a brand new car, too. This particular Celine S7 literally had never run before coming to the track here. And one of the drivers is a local driver. Now, the Conrad car, which had won the last race at Sebring, had been running anywhere between 2.5 and 3 seconds back, suddenly has dropped back a lot. So maybe he is having more of an oversteer problem. They alluded to that later, a little earlier on. They said the car was getting really tail happy. And indeed, we've seen it quite a few times. Coming off the corner, you can watch the car try to put power down. It isn't doing it very effectively today.
There you see the Conrad car running in 10th overall and second in the GTS class. Right now, about 6 seconds behind Lambert, who runs in the class lead. As Bill said, Bruno's been pulling away, and Conrad has fallen back here in this last short while, so the handling beginning to deteriorate on this car. They reported, Oliver Gavin, who started the car, reported a serious handling problem the farther in they went in the first stint in the race.
For a driver, there really isn't anything much worse when you're on a very high-speed circuit like this, down, particularly down through the S's, right there where he is. If a car is tail happy, if the tail is trying to pass the front, it is a very uncomfortable feeling.
Now, this car has been a little bit controversial in coming out. These GTS cars are supposed to be production-based machines.
Right.
There will be a street version of this Celine, but the people that are competing with it feel like they designed the race car and they're going to build some street-legal versions of it versus building a racing version of a street-legal car like the Vipers or Corvettes.
Oh, we saw pictures of the street car, and I would love one, but you're going to have to buy it for me because I can't afford it. It's a beautiful car, and in fact, they're right, because this particular car is built by Malik Engineering. It's another one of the many English firms been around forever. They used to build very small cars, little tiny engines, but I guess they were contacted by Steve Saleem and asked to do the engineering and build work on this particular car. It's a beautiful piece.
About $350,000 for the street version of the Celine S7.
Daddy,
yeah.
Can I please?
Help me, please. So there you look at Franz Conrad running 10th overall and again second in GTS. He's now fallen 7.7 seconds behind the class leader, Bruno Lambert.
7-liter alloy Ford in the midships on this car. Can't really call them rear engine, even though the driver is sitting in front, but the engine is well ahead of the rear wheels, and it's very reminiscent of the old McLaren.
Here's the GTS leader in. Lambert brings the other Celine onto pit road. Let's go down there now.
Bruno Lambert driving the car. Ian McKellar Jr., who's raced the 800 brake horsepower TVR Speed 12 in the British Championship, will also drive this car. And as you rightly said, Ray Malik Limited, who do the chassis origination and some of the design on the Celine car, have only run two laps before they brought the car to Donington Park, and in those two laps, it ate three fuel pumps. So they are hoping for a clean run. This is their first ever effort racing the Celine.
Usually a fuel pump failure when you have a brand new car, it's just having some sort of debris in the tank itself.
Second place car in the background there, Stefan Johansson pitting the Audi, and here's one of the Panos machines. That's David Brabham in from fourth place. We look back now at what was the second place car, and we go to Calvin.
Well, the Audi is in, and it's Guy Smith now getting behind the wheel of the Golf machine. Looks like a routine stop, tires going on, so they're actually single stinting their tires. Most of the guys like to double stint, but with these conditions, they really want to be on top of things. They're still trying to learn the etiquette. There, and Guy Smith will be one of the Bentley boys at Le Mans this year.
Stalled it.
He did for a moment. Also the Pescarola car, that's a very unusual car right there, and one that we saw briefly at Sebring. It is Peugeot powered. Very, very unusual.
Driver change ongoing on pit road. Let's go back to Martin.
Bill Adam, you're absolutely right. This is a very unusual car and never been seen apart from Sebring on the continental USA. Henri Pescarolo has concentrated with this car on Le Mans, and last year this car was the best non-Audi finisher at the French 24-hour Classic. I'm not sure what the French for softly, softly catchy monkey is, but it may be Pescarolo, because you never notice this car in the race. They don't hit anything, they're never flamboyant, but they always get the job done. The young driver combination they've got is very quick, the car is very reliable, and it's working its way up the leaderboard as others fall by the wayside.
That's the trouble with the pressure coming to the pneumatic wrench that took the lug off that front tire, and now they're going to double check and make sure everything's on tight, because you don't want a wheel coming off at speed out of the track.
Exactly. Just to go back for a moment too, talking about single stinting the tires on the Audi, which is so unusual. Talking earlier with the Michelin engineers, they were saying how they ended up running a soft compound of Michelin here, partly because the track is in such great condition and partly because of the extremely cold temperatures we have today. But they are running tires they have never before run, so they really don't have very much data on it. They don't know how they're going to run.
And look at the Peugeot engine garage chassis slide around when you applied the power coming off of pit road. Well, Tom Christensen has done his share of slipping and sliding today, but he's managed to hold it on the track and stay in the lead. He's had contact with another car, got penalized for it, and still comes out on top by now a full lap over the second place car as a result of the Stefan Johansson pit stop a minute ago.
Such a blindingly fast car. This is just so intimidating going down through the S's here. These cars have been reaching 175 or 100. Well, there's our telemetry right there, which gives you an idea. Watch the acceleration graph particularly. From 170 miles an hour, instantly back down to 90, and then look at the acceleration again.
Coppice corner. Double apex turn.
That has got to be the ultimate kick in that car. Just a rocket. Now, something here, keep in mind for later, is pay attention to the G-force, the little tiny lateral force right here. You see 1.6, 1.7 as they go through the slow corners. Now, remember that for later. We'll try and get on board one of the GT Porsches, and you'll see that at low speed, the cars are fairly similar. They're only putting out about the same downforce on the very slow corners. But the aerodynamics on these cars, well, that's a whole different story. We'll try to show that to you.
A little puff of smoke out of the Peugeot there just a minute ago as the leader comes on the pit road. We were going to commercial. We're going to stick right here while Tom Christensen comes in the pit lane. Now, he's done a double stint behind the wheel of the car. Expect he'll get out and give way to his teammate, Dindo Capello.
Just unplugged himself right there. You saw the right hand reach up, pull the switch off the dashboard. That's his radio.
Here he comes, Calvin Fish.
Tom Christensen jumps out. Ronaldo Capello jumps in. He has minimal Donington Park racetrack. He's only got a handful of laps this weekend. Tom has gone to look at the testing in the car, and Dindo's never done this before. So Christensen is the man. He's the fastest man on the team right now, and he knows this track very well. The driver change looks like it's going routine. Fuel is going in. Once that is complete, we're going to see a tire change as well. So Martin Haven, more news for you.
Dramatic scenes in the BMW pit. The 42 car came in with Jörg Müller at the wheel. They completed a regular stop, but it's had damage on the right-hand side and now keeps bursting into flames around the exhaust exit port. Now the team are standing in place with fire extinguishers. bizarre thing is that Jörg hasn't even turned the engine over at this stage. He expects a bit of flames back when he does start it up, but it doesn't seem to be related to the engine, so they have got a slightly more major problem than they thought they had when the car was half a lap away from the pits.
Martin, actually that is totally related to the engine. The flames were coming out the exhaust pipe. In fact, we can watch right now. There is something has broken in the fuel system, and instead of dumping small amounts of fuel into the cylinder, they must be getting giant amounts.
Fuel injection.
Yeah. I would say a pump is broken.
So problems for the BMWs. The other car, the team car, was out earlier in the race in the garage a couple of times with electrical system problems, and now this one for Jörg Müller with the fuel system going awry, part of the growing pains of developing a new power plant that this team is struggling through.
BMW flamethrower.
Dindo Capello is the race leader, having taken over the Audi R8 from Tom Christensen. They're out in front by a lap and 35 seconds over their team car in second position.
The American Le Mans Series at Donington Park is brought to you by Audi.
Really by pride and joy. I know it's weed-free. I know it's dandelion-free. I do it by using Scott's Turf Builder Plus 2. The light granule sticks to that wet leaf much easier than a heavy granule, which would fall off. It doesn't stick. It just doesn't work.
I think it's the greatest product ever made.
Insightful columns, exclusive interviews, dazzling photography. Every month in Le Mans and Sports Car Racer magazine. New from the publishers of F1 Racing and Autosport. Call 1-800-800-3921 to subscribe. It's the fastest way to keep track.
Two teams, one goal, $1 million on the line.
We stand nothing to lose. We stand everything to gain.
The Demons and their hellacious defense look to end the Eastern Division champs' thrilling season. Both teams with 1 million reasons to leave it all on the field. The XFL playoffs, NBC tonight.
Back at Donington Park in central England, it is Dindo Capello now leading in the Audi R8 by about 29.6 seconds over Emanuele Pirro, the pit stop a minute ago, with the driver change for this number one car, allowing the team car to unlap himself and eliminate about half the distance. Now, that car, all that ground they just made up, they're going to give it up for their pit stop because they're in now. There's Emanuele Pirro getting his service. You see the fuel going in. We'll see if they change tires. It looks like they're in position to.
Yeah, although I'm curious about what that little gesture was he just made right there. He was telling somebody just to back away and not do something. I wonder if it was maybe the front tires. He might want to save a little bit of time. The other thing that he did, as a matter of fact, that's exactly, he said he did not want tires. So he now is going to try and salvage track position. And interesting, we saw Capello when he went back on the track. He was moving the car around a lot, visibly not nearly as comfortable as Tom Christensen was, perhaps because of the fact that it was brought up that he didn't do very much testing.
And he came out just in front of the team car, this car, Pirro, just in front of Capello in the other car, so he's basically on the tail end of the lead lap. You see the other lead car right behind him there in the frame. Let's go down to the Audi pit to Calvin.
Well, Tom Christensen had a great opening stint. How's the car today, and the conditions must be pretty tough?
Yeah, they are, because obviously the surface is very smooth and it's very cold. And with our Le Mans cars on this circuit, the tires work very well. But you start to slide a little bit after some laps, and you wonder, can you do two stints on them and not? And this was my only worry, apart from the stop and go. But I did two stints on the tires, and the car runs beautifully.
Yeah, we're going to have a chat here with an interested spectator, Alan McNish, current ALMS champion. Good to see you, mate. How the testing tour has been going with the Toyota?
It's been good. We've had the first test. Everything ran better than expected, to be honest. We did quite a lot of miles, and I was particularly pleased to get in, feel the car, and actually feel quite confident in it.
I understand you've had a few offers for the month of June. Everyone's keen to have you in their car. I know Stefan Johansson has spoken to you. Panos was out there this morning trying to pull you over his way. Any chance of seeing you at Le Mans this year?
I think there's a very high chance of seeing him at Le Mans. However, I think there's a very low chance of seeing me actually in a car. I want to go because I want to see the race. I want to see it from the other side of the fence and not have to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning, go out and do a triple stint. And I want to enjoy seeing you guys at 9 in the morning, really bleary-eyed and red-eyed. But I'll be there as a spectator, not as a racer.
All right, Alan, great to see you.
Good to see you. Thanks.
Alan McNish, the 2000 American Le Mans Series champion, now signed to be the test driver for Toyota as they develop an entry into the Formula One Grand Prix Championship for next season.
So what a driver.
Taking him out of sports car competition. This is to put the second place car one lap down. The yellow winged Audi with Dindo Capello is the leader. And it is Emanuele Pirro in the red winged Audi that is in second place, again trying to keep him going a lap down.
I suspect you're going to see the number one car go by here pretty quickly because he made up a tremendous amount of ground.
Well, now, how many laps off the pit lane will it take Pirro in the two car, the red wing one trying to stay on the lead lap, to get the heat up in his tires where he can run the same pace as the car behind him?
Well, based on the fact that they're using these ultra-soft Michelin tires, even in weather as cold as this, they'll be at totally the temperature within 2 to 3 laps.
So he's basically at that point now.
He will be, yes.
And here comes Capello up the inside. Remember, we told you earlier, the Audi teams have, the drivers have no team orders. They're free to race each other as hard as they want to for the win. The only order is don't take each other out.
Oh, boy, if you do that, that's your last race for Audi, or for anybody for that matter. Now, here is this ultra-high-speed downhill section. There's the number 21 car that both of these Audis have hit during this race. And he stayed well out of their way that time, wanted nothing to do with them.
And look at this now, the race for second is tightened up now as Guy Smith there in the Gulf car, there he is caught up to Pirro. So they're just about a second apart on the racetrack for second place.
And you can bet that every single person here in this huge crowd will be cheering for Guy Smith. He is very much a local hero. And of course, again, to go back to Gulf colors on this car, that this is the old British team John Wire Racing. So it has huge spectator appeal around here.
Guy Smith is from Yorkshire, England, which is not all that far from here. He's 25-year-old.
Where they make puddings, right?
I think so. Uh-huh. Let's go to Martin.
That's where they make puddings and an awful lot of other things. In fact, Stefan Johansson is a real local hero as well. He raced so long in Britain before he went to the States that he used to be referred to as Steve Johnson rather than Stefan Johansson. And he and Guy Smith will know a lot about the changeable weather. Now, the cameras have picked up a few rain spots just in the last couple of laps, and that may just be a change in the weather coming through. The forecast was for rain in the Midlands of Great Britain. That's where we are at the moment, and there are just a few spots of rain falling. Prior to the start of this American Le Mans race, we saw four cars off on a support race first lap because there was a sprinkle of rain. We're on the flight path for the East Midlands Airport here. That means a lot of aviation fuel gets into the tarmac, and the moment it gets a drop of water on it, it goes straight from being dry to ice.
Look at this race for second in traffic. Guy Smith pursuing Pirro in the factory Audi determinedly.
Yes, he is. The Pride of England is up here right now. This will be a lot of ego and a lot of excitement just driving Guy to go on and pass that car. This is such fun for a driver at this point. When you get a truly good car, you've got something in your teeth to really go for it. You want to show off to friends and family and have the people standing cheering for you. It's very inspirational.
Remember that the Gulf car, the 7 car, the blue and orange customer Audi, had a big crash at the end of qualifying yesterday. The team working late into the night last night to repair the machine. It has been fast all race long. Obviously none the worse for wear, and a tip of the cap to them for doing such a terrific job
Indeed.
To get that car back squared away.
Yeah, perfect job by the crew. That's always a great moral booster for the crew.
We'll take a break here and come back with more of our coverage of the American Le Mans Series in just a moment on NBC.
The Pano's Racing School at Road Atlanta, Sebring, and coming to Texas Motor Speedway. 1-888-282-GTRA.
Monday, 8, 7 Central.
Let's play
The Weakest Link.
They answer questions to get rich.
Correct.
But first, they face Anne.
Is there any beginning to your knowledge? Perhaps you wandered into the wrong studio.
Sweetheart, it's easy when you have the answer.
Weakest Link premieres this Monday at 8, 7 Central on NBC.
Monday at 8, 7 Central, don't miss the premiere of Weakest Link. It's the only game that's faster than Millionaire and more suspenseful than Survivor. That's Weakest Link premiering Monday at 8, 7 Central on NBC. Here's the race for second.
Yeah, right now Guy Smith is looking for the Weakest Link up ahead. He's trying to get by Piero in there. He's going to try him down the inside. No back outside. He's forced him too deep. He's got it. He did a great bait job there. He made Piero go down far too deep in the corner and just swung on the inside and took the exit.
Great job. So Guy Smith, the second, putting the customer Audi in between the two factory machines. Here's another look.
Perfect job. He baited him up the inside. How deep Piero is getting there, he can't get the car to turn. Smith, on the other hand, does that late apex under full power here, has the drive off the corner. What a terrific pass.
Watching the rearview mirror too much?
That's exactly what it is.
Uh-oh, Jan Magnussen's in trouble, stuck in the gravel trap.
That's the Michelin gravel tire.
That is called a helping hand, is what it is. Needing a boost out of the gravel.
They have had the roughest weekend here. That, much to their dismay, they have not been able to get the Panos to really work well. It's been so frustrating for all of them. They've gone through electronic gearbox problems. The cars haven't been shifting well. They've had very little downforce. And just so frustrating. It's a lot more of a tribute to Magnussen and Brabham. All of them, they're able to keep trying because sometimes you're just ready to give up.
Magnussen was running in fifth, at the time of his spin. And he is losing ground now while they dig him out of the kitty litter. Let's go to the GT class leader. Haven't looked in on them in just a while. Lucas Lohr is out in front of that class, driving one of the Alex Job Racing Porsches. Here he comes down the hill. That would be the second place car, team car, painted alike. That would be Christian Menzel, who runs in second spot. He's a lap and 15 seconds behind Lucas Lohr. And there's Lucas. Hey, what's that
and
on the windshield?
Look at the windshield. Yeah, I was just noticing that. So he may be getting some of this English summertime weather coming back to us. It has been astonishing. The crowd that has turned up today, they bring their families here. There's kids every place. There's bands playing. And much to my heart's joy in the pit, they have this huge ice cream van selling all kinds of ice cream in this freezing cold weather.
Yeah, it's about 45 degrees here, and it is 45 degrees and misty and foggy and somewhat rainy. Bill is from Miami. I'm living in North Carolina. I played golf in shorts on Tuesday of this week. This has been quite a shock to be over here for the last few days.
Yeah.
And it's been hard on these race cars, too. Watch one of the Panos cars there try to work his way up through the slower cars. Wow. That's got to be tough to be one of these GT drivers and have to, you know, you're trying to concentrate on driving the fastest lap that you can around the racetrack, but you have to be looking in the mirrors and give way to the prototype cars at the same time.
You really do. You can have some very short races by not watching the mirror. You take two cars out of the race and potentially very, very dangerous. So it does take an added element of skill for these drivers.
Sasha Mawson is on board that Porsche that is leading the GT class. Lucas Lohr started the machine right behind them, the somewhat beaten and battered number 42 BMW that had its problems on pit road with the fuel system we saw earlier.
Now, this should be a good indication of just how much horsepower this BMW's got. They're going to go through a hairpin right here, coming out of the front straight. Now let's see how the two cars compare. That's not that bad. I don't see very much to complain about there.
Well, again, though, there was one of the prototype cars coming by on the right, and Moeller, who's driving the BMW now, probably saw that, knew he didn't have any room to pull out to try a pass.
Okay, now, watch telemetry down through here. These high-speed S's, look what he's pulling. 1.8 is the highest we saw. 130 miles an hour, go through this corner, 1.6.
And then back up here, watch acceleration 100. Just over 1.3 again. So back up to almost 130. Now, tuck that away in your mind, and we'll take a look at one of the LMP cars to see what they do down through here. This is where the high-speed aero packages really make such a dramatic difference.
These GT cars are the closest thing to a production machine you'll get.
They are.
In this form of racing. They are obviously very heavily modified for racing, but it starts off as your basic production car.
Now, here we have BMW playing a game with Porsche. I'll guarantee that his team manager says, go out, sit on his tail, try to rattle him, try and get him to make a mistake. Don't worry about passing, just get there and look, move to the left, move to the right, occupy the mirror. Smart move by the Porsche.
Now the BMW is only probably, 30 laps behind him?
Exactly, and I with Alex Job's experience here, he would probably radio out and say, let him go, don't take a chance.
Well, let's see exactly what he is behind him here. Looking down for where Jörg Müller is, he's 6 laps behind him.
That poor little car is really battered. You see both flares are missing down the right-hand side from the contact with one of the banks here. And still spinning a lot. Maybe what it was one of the injectors might have been stuck while the car was stopped in the pits, allowed a cylinder to fill up with a lot of fuel, and as he turned it over, it couldn't possibly ignite it, but would push it down the exhaust pipe, and that's where it would ignite with the big flames.
We've talked a lot about the BMW GT car today, but let's talk about the Porsche. Steady, right on through the day, no problems. The one pit stop strategy going to make their way through the day. It's been a very flawless race for them so far.
It has.
Let's go back to the lead car and make that comparison
we were
talking about a minute ago with the telemetry and the speeds.
Now look, here's the high speed end of the track. Look at this, almost 180 miles an hour. Watch the G loading through the corner. Over 2 right there, accelerates back up. There's 150, 160 again, 170. And you see the G-force, it literally is pegging it over the side. We saw it at 40, 50 miles per hour in the hairpins. The cars are very close. They're both about 1.6. In around there, but suddenly at high speed, where the underbody, where the wings, where everything takes effect, big changes.
More trouble for the Panos team. That is the other car. That's not Magnussen, so that would be Klaus Graf, who is stuck in the kitty litter, maybe in the same spot. They've been having brake problems with these cars all weekend long. Calvin Fish, talk about that a little more for us, if you would, please.
Well, Jan Magnussen had the off. Just before the off, he'd radioed in and said his brakes had gone away, so that explains why he did go off course. They brought the car immediately into the garage. There's something major going on the left front of the car. The brake must have actually broken because they cannot get the wheel off. They've got a hammer and a screwdriver inside the wheel there trying to loosen everything up. So this is a lengthy stop. It's been a catalogue of disasters for this Panos team this weekend. Problems with the power steering in the warm-up. They've had brake problems on the other car mainly, and then it sort of switched itself to this car this morning. So it's been a real headache for these boys. And once again, they're still looking for a little bit more power from that Zytek engine.
We're about to watch real bedlam is going to take place right here in just a second. If this tractor tries to pull it forward, it's going to be like dragging a cheese wedge through the cheese. It's just going to fill the car up with stones. He needs to pull it out from the back.
Well, while they try and dig Klaus Graf out of the kitty litter, we will take a look at the race leader. It is Dindo Capello out in front by a full lap over his team car. Come back with more from Donington in just a moment. You know, the 2001 Star Mazda season opened at the Texas Motor Speedway with a 40-car strong field. The professional spec racing started tight and ended with a last-lap battle for the top spot. Pole sitter Scott Jenkins got together with Scott Bradley for second, then Bradley put on a charge against Matt Beardsley, coming to the line in what may have been the closest finish in series history. Round two at Sebring, first lap contact sent pole sitter David Sternberg around, and Scott Bradley made a challenge for the lead, but Chad Block held on for the victory. Next, it's on to Sears Point, where Matt Beardsley hopes to defend his 2000 win.
The usual, gentlemen?
Well, perhaps for Emmett, but I'll be having tea. Well, I'm the designated driver.
Not so quick, friend. I'll be having the tea, as I'm to be the driver.
Deny yourself if you like, but I'll be a-driving.
Boxster. What only a Porsche brings to driving.
The world's best.
best in sports car racing returns to North America July 22nd when the American Le Mans Series Stars and Cars battled it out at the X Factor Grand Prix of Sonoma at California's Sears Point Raceway. Don't miss this chance to see Le Mans in America. Get your tickets now by calling 1-800-870-7223.
Chateau Elan Hotels and Resorts, the subtle difference of excellence.
The Olympic Winter Games from Salt Lake, coming in 300 days on America's Olympic Network, NBC.
The American Le Mans Series at Donington Park is brought to you by Porsche. Discover what only Porsche brings to driving.
Getting down toward the finish of round three of the American Le Mans Series for 2001 at Donington Park in central England. Dindo Capello, Guy Smith, and Emanuele Piro in three Audis. One first, second, and third, the two factory cars. First and third with the privateer Audi, the customer car, sandwiched in the middle. There is the leader. Basically, they've led the whole race through. Tom Christensen started the car. The only time he didn't have the lead was when he punted another car off the course earlier and got a stop-and-go penalty and then made a scheduled pit stop. Otherwise, it's been clean and clear for this car the entire distance.
It's almost a typical thing. They run this with such a wonderful precision, and Christensen just fits right into that. That this is such a well-oiled team. We have to just stand and admire them.
You mentioned at the top of our show, it's like watching Tiger Woods play golf and Michael Jordan play basketball. Some interesting things here on the grounds at Donington Park, including a terrific museum of vintage race cars out in front that Calvin Fish went for a look at earlier.
It was in 1937 that a young lad from Leicester, Tom Wheatcroft, watched his very first motor race. His vantage point was the Melbourne Loop here on the old Donington Park racetrack. And he watched cars such as the Auto Juniors crest this amazing hill and thunder off into the distance. It was this spectacle that really created the enthusiasm and passion that Tom still has for motorsports today.
I remember very, very well in 1938, Nuvolari winning here, and I remember him standing in the trophy, putting him in the trophy he won. It was such a big trophy.
In the early 1970s, Tom, now a successful businessman, purchased Donington Park, which was now in a state of ruin. He rebuilt the track and reopened it in 1977.
Having re-established Donington Park as one of the premier racing facilities in this country, Tom Wheatcroft's goal now was to have a running of a Grand Prix here at his track. This he did in 1993 with the running of the European Grand Prix, and the race was won by the legendary late Ayrton Senna in this McLaren. And this car takes pride of place in what is now the world's largest collection of Grand Prix cars.
It is called the Donington Collection and does not only include current generation Grand Prix cars, but race cars covering seven decades. It includes many of Sir Jack Brabham's finest race cars, Nigel Mansell's famous World Championship winning number 5 Williams, the Curious Tyrrell six-wheeler, and the first Grand Prix car to bear the name of Jackie Stewart, driven by now Panos driver Jan Magnussen. America is represented with Dan Gurney's Eagle, and the one thing that's been consistent throughout the history of Donington Park has been the four rings of Audi.
It really is a fantastic, amazing collection of racing automobiles
phenomenal.
That is on the grounds here at Donington.
Just phenomenal.
Very enjoyable experience we went through there on Thursday afternoon here at the racetrack. While you were watching that, this car, the leader, just let out a huge plume of smoke under braking at one of the corners. He seems to be at full speed and no harm, no foul, but it got our attention for a minute real quick.
It did. Every once in a while they do that. We saw earlier, I think it was Piro that came into one of the corners. It looked like he locked up the right rear. And there are suggestions that the Audis have ABS and traction control and this and that other thing, but when they do that, that's not an ABS function.
Dindo Capello across the start-finish line, back off into the first corner. Let's see if we see anything behind the car.
Not a thing.
It's pretty clean. Let's take a look at what happened earlier when I mentioned a minute ago the big puff of smoke that came out of the car. Watch this.
Now, just before that smoke occurred, there was a flame out. Well, let's see as he goes around.
It looked like he had the right front locked up to me, Bill.
There was a flame back there, too.
Yeah, that was, I think, a little backfire when he downshifted, but he was dragging that right front tire all the way down the hill into that corner.
I hope that's all it was.
Calvin's down in the Audi pit. What do you think, Calvin? What are they saying?
Well, with the Audi situation, guys, what we have is that they're a little out of sync. Remember, the number two car had that flat tire. What that means is they should be able to go the rest of the distance on gas, the number one car expecting a splash. But more importantly, Guy Smith driving that golf car, he expected in as well. I just spoke to Stefan Johansson. He says, I doubt we can get to the finish. That may cost them second place here today.
So we've got possibly the leader needing a splash of fuel. And that won't endanger his lead. But second place may change hands because of a splash of fuel. Next race for the American Le Mans Series is overseas here as the build-up to the Great French 24-hour race continues. Jarama, Spain on May the 20th. And then after the Le Mans race in mid-June, it's back to the USA and back on NBC, July 22nd, Sears Point Raceway in Sonoma, California. We'll also go on with you to Mosport in Canada. And a new race, Lexington, Ohio. That's the Mid-Ohio Sports Car Course, named this week to replace the Mont-Tremblant course, a race scheduled for Quebec, canceled because of some difficulties with the circuit. We're going to go to Mid-Ohio now on August 25th. You'll see it on NBC. And that last race on the schedule in Australia, originally going to be held in the city of Adelaide. That venue not going to be the place anymore, but they tell us there will be an Australia race. It's just a matter of where it's going to be. We're hearing rumors that Sydney is the likely location.
We hope.
Let's take a break. Getting close to the finish, waiting for a fuel stop on this car, the race leader, driven by Dindo Capello.
All new NBC Tuesday. Brian Dennehy proves there's no shame in a father sharing his love for his son.
I love you. Well, that's enough. No more hugs till somebody dies, huh?
It's an all-new Fighting Fitzgeralds, Tuesday at 8, 7 Central on NBC.
The second-place car of Guy Smith is on pit road for his splash of fuel, and it has been a forever pit stop. What in the world has taken him so long?
You saw frustration right there from Guy's standpoint. I agree with him. He's saying, look, we only need a little bit of gas. Get us out of here.
He came down the pit lane, and we'll try and get another look at it here in a minute, but he came down the pit lane and stopped the car, and the fuel man wasn't even in position. He kind of walked around the car, grabbed the coupling off the hook, brought it down to the car. I mean, it looked like, you know, no big deal. Time's of no issue here.
Maybe this is one more thing to appreciate about Yost Racing.
Boy.
They're prepared for every eventuality.
You got to think. I mean, you're racing for second spot in the final laps. You know you need a splash and go, and the guy you're racing doesn't. You don't want to give it away.
Yeah.
Now Guy Smith back on course and off on the charge. And when he comes back around to the start-finish line, we'll get an idea of exactly the interval between himself and Emanuele Pirro in the number two factory Audi.
You know, just watching the telemetry, just a second ago, I timed the acceleration from 80 miles an hour up to 140, just under 4 seconds.
It's going to be a long way because Pirro's already across the start-finish line, and Smith is just coming down to the S turn that leads him down to the Melbourne hairpin. And he's got a long way to go to try and catch up and reclaim that second spot.
I don't think he can do it with just this little bit of time left, unless Pirro makes a mistake.
I'd love to get another look at that when he came down pit road. We were just coming out of the commercial break when he came in, and you at home did not see the casualness with which they approached the start of the pit stop. It really was unbelievable.
Boy, you've got to keep all of your crew right on their toes. You can't let anybody relax. And you've got to have people thinking all the time, well, what if, what might, and be prepared for these things.
He's down about 12 seconds to Emanuele Pirro. He's 12 seconds down, so that's time. I mean, I'll bet he lost half of that.
Yeah, he's trying very hard, too. Watch from the edge of the road here, how much of this bump he uses up. Right to the edge. And that's the thing that caused the crash of this car yesterday in qualifying, by going just an inch over that edge.
Let's take another look back at what happened when he came down pit road. This happened while you were in the commercial break, and then you saw the end of the pit stop. But I want you to watch the fuel man, I guess we'll call him, and watch this. We kind of picked it up a little bit late, but he was standing there.
Oh, but even right there, you saw by his actions, he wasn't really trying to get that thing in to save half a second. And in turn, Guy is sitting in the car waving his hand in frustration.
Go, go, go. The fuel nozzle hangs on a hook up above the pit. It's not something he carries around the car with him. And instead of being around to the far side of the car, when it pulls in and having that fuel nozzle in his hand ready to plug in, it was hanging on the hook and the car was at a complete stop before he came around the back of the car. So that cost him a good shot at second place. They're too far behind.
It cost a few seconds. And when you look at these guys running, only half a second apart on the track, that's a big loss.
Let's go to Calvin Fish.
Just a quick update on the Audi guy. One machine, any time it should be a time stop. They will not need a full fuel load, of course, about 5 seconds, and we'll see the Yost team go to work. Hopefully they'll be set up a little bit better than Johansson's team, but the scary part is whenever you bring the car in, you have to shut it down for fuel. You just hope that car refires up and makes it to the checkered flag.
So waiting to see what happens when the leader comes in. Good part is he's got a lap, which is about a minute 25 seconds, plus another 32 seconds on the second place car. So
Calvin brought out a very valid point. It's one of the big gasps of any race is when a driver shuts the car off, and you always hope in the back of your mind that something hasn't drained your battery or something hasn't gone awry in the starter motor.
Let's take a look at some of the other classes here as we close in on the finish of the race. There's Guy Smith, first of all, then, who has fallen to third behind the two factory Audis because of that lengthy pit stop there just a minute ago. Now some of the other class leaders. The LMP 675 class leader is the Pilby Nissan of Warren Carway, and he runs back in seventh overall.
Did a fine job surviving two Audi hits, and he's still gone on. That car appears to be untouched by the hit. They weren't really difficult hits, more brushes. In fact, he almost got a Porsche brush, right? Oh, gee.
That's Carway, middle car of the three in the frame. I believe the other car that is in the frame with him is one of the GT class leaders, one of the Alex Job Racing Porsches. Matter of fact, they're both in the frame there, the yellow and white Porsches. It is the Lucas Lohr Sascha Mawson car that's leading the class and running 10th overall. Christian Menzel and Randy Popes, the team drivers of the other car, running in the 11th position and second in GT. Here's our 675 class leader.
These are good little race cars, really very affordable when you compare them against the big LMP cars. For a chassis, you're talking about $150,000, as these fellows told me. The motor in the car, they're saying, without question, you could do it for another $30,000. So for $180,000 to $200,000 range, they've got a race car here that's going to finish in very good order today.
Again, running seventh overall and first in the LMP 675 class.
Very lightweight.
been punted by both Audis today and still survived to see the finish and win the class.
It still looks pretty. I don't see any marks down the side either. And the little winglets on the nose, they're still in place.
As he goes by the GT class leader, that's the 23 Porsche, Sascha Mawson, and Lucas Lohr, the co-drivers on that car. Pretty much had a problem-free day. The one pit stop strategy that we talked about coming in that the Porsches could get away with in this timed race, and really the BMW's problems keeping it from being a serious challenger to Porsche for the win today.
Yeah, although I think that probably the fuel situation would have helped Porsche win it, even had BMW not had problems. Just that their economy makes it such a luxury to be able to go beyond the 90-minute point. So you get more than halfway, and you only have to do that single stop. What a job, too, for Alex Job one more time. This man has come from amateur racing and has just built such a great team.
GTS class leader, the Salines, have been battling it out all day. It looks like it will be this car, Ian McKellar and Bruno Lambert, the co-drivers, that will come out on top, as right now they have a lead on the team machine, the other Saline, rather, by about four laps. So not going to be much of a contest in the finish there. There's McKellar in the car. Beautiful looking Celine machine. Not challenged by the Corvettes here because the Corvettes aren't making the European races. But when we get back to the States, that's going to be one whale of a battle in GTS. Closing in on the checkered flag in round three of the American Le Mans Series for 2001 at Donington Park in England. We'll come back and salute our winners with the checkers wave in just a moment on NBC.
If a car company puts a little sports car in everything it builds, imagine what happens when it builds a sports car.
Zoom, zoom.
Zoom, zoom, zoom. Zoom, zoom, zoom. Yeah, zoom, 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 zoom.
Introducing the new Mazda Miata. Six speeds, VVT engine, even more fun.
Yeah, 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 zoom.
The company that reinvented the Roadster keeps reinventing the Roadster.
Roundup. It will be your greatest enemy when you take over the weed family.
Me? Leave the family?
New Roundup is stronger, faster. It kills to the root.
So when I take over, we'll all be dead?
New Roundup. No root, no weed, no problem.
How can you keep track of the latest in sports car racing? Monthly. With Le Mans and Sports Car Racer magazine. New from the publishers of F1 Racing and Autosport. Call 1-800-800-3921 to subscribe. It's the fastest way to keep track.
Lead car is on pit road for his final splash and dash stop for fuel. It is Dindo Capello who comes in now with just 5 minutes and 12 seconds remaining in this timed race. Fuel in. Here's that quick start the car moment. He's off and gone.
That's a pretty polished stop. You saw as he came up to place, just what you pointed out with the golf team, where the fueler was very kind of lackadaisical. Yost team were dead ready for this. Also, the driver had presence of mind to put his visor down. He was getting a little bit of cool air as he pulled in. Did not want to take a chance of having gasoline splash in his eyes, so just very calmly pulled the visor back into place. That's heads up.
Now, I know it's a penalty if the fuel man's visor is tipped up. What about the driver? Does he have to keep that visor down on a fuel stop? I don't know that.
I don't know either. I would imagine so. That's something that has never come up.
Maybe that's the other reason he had the presence of mind to pop it down, is to make sure he didn't get a penalty for that. Telemetry on board. He's out in front. Capello here is on his team car by a lap and 31 seconds. So it's home free from here as long as he stays on the track and keeps it running to the finish. And it looks like the battle for second is getting a little tight. Emanuele Pirro is now up on Guy Smith by just 4 seconds.
Yeah, Guy Smith is really getting the crowd. But even as we're sitting here right now, the crowd has packed the front straight, and they're like three or four deep all the way along this fence. They're seemingly oblivious to the cold that is killing us, and yeah, they're just having a wonderful day out here watching motor racing.
Guy Smith made a bold move for second spot earlier to get around the other factory Audi, to get around that car. Then lost second spot with the lackadaisical pit stop for fuel a minute ago. Now here's second. Let's look back in the frame, see if we can see.
I didn't yet.
Third, not yet.
That's the Chrysler behind, and then the 21 Pillbeam, the LM 675 car with the headlights on right there.
Yeah, so he's a long way behind. Telemetry says he's only 4 seconds back, but he's got more than that to make up. Now the telemetry update saying he's 30 seconds behind. So there you go.
Somebody forgot to wind it.
Well, electronics. 675 class leader, Warren Carway.
These fellas all have a good celebration tonight. Both local, the one said he lives about 9 miles from the track, and the other fellow has a house in London. This is great to go to this event and do such a good job.
Carway, the 98 British F3 national runner-up. He's run a lot of different things over the last several years, different cars. He has run Formula Opel in Europe, among other things, done some FIA sports racing, but now behind the wheel in this Le Mans-style car.
And they were talking about their budget as well. They just don't have the money to do a really extensive car, so they're only running a 3-liter motor in this, when they could go up to 3.4 without a problem. Similarly, they could run up to 2-inch wider rear wheels and tires, but can't afford it.
Money, gotta have it to race. The old saying, money buys speed, is very true.
Yeah, and it hasn't hurt them to do that today. So you wonder, well, if they had the advantage of more torque, more horsepower, plus more rubber on the ground, they're gonna be even faster.
should be coming up on the white flag lap here very shortly. We're inside of a minute 50 in this timed race. And at a minute 25 to get around here, we'll keep an eye out for the lead outie of Dindo Capello and see when he comes across the start finish line if he gets the signal that it is the final lap. Here's the GT class leader. Let's go to pit road and Martin Haven.
The Alex Job 22 car, the sister car to this car, which is in second in the GT class, has just stopped for a splash of fuel. It's the third place car. Alex Job is not yet certain.
And we apologize for the difficulties with Martin's transmission from pit road. The gist of it, I think you caught there. We're not certain whether this car is going to have to stop for a splash of fuel or not.
I can't imagine. At this point in the race, I think you risk it. You just back off. You short shift every place you can, which means instead of taking it all the way to the red line, you shift at very low RPM because you've got the luxury of having a relatively good, safe race already run. So don't pull into the pits right now.
And we wait on the leader to come to the start finish line and begin the last lap of today's race. Here he comes, Dindo Capello across the stripe, final lap of the event here in Donington Park. We didn't see a white flag,
but the
starter has the checkered flag in his hand, and we are inside the final lap of the race. Overseas, they don't use the white flag much. That's kind of an American racing thing.
He's probably too cold to put it out. Poor chap's been standing up there all day in this driving wind.
Yeah. Well, we came on the air basically with a tribute to this car and this team and its drivers, saying what a maestro-like performance they have put on for the last year and some in Le Mans racing. They came here to Donington Park today, and this team in particular have dominated. They've led all but a few laps of this race when they made a pit stop and got a penalty earlier.
They deserve all of the accolades, and it is really fun to watch because we're seeing a dynasty. We're seeing something that will elevate all of the other teams upward. You always try to emulate the very best, and when Tiger Woods comes out and you watch him shoot, every young boy in the country wants to play golf like Tiger. I'd like to play golf like Tiger too.
Yeah.
So for the Yost team, they do a magnificent job with a car that is so well engineered, and everybody now has to raise the bar to try and match them. That's good for motorsport.
Dindo Capello, the driver on board the car now, the 36-year-old Italian, has won both of the American Le Mans Series races this year, now make it three in a row. Checkered flag is up. Capello and his teammate Tom Christensen score the win at Donington Park, England. We follow the other class winners as they come to the start-finish line. As Capello begins his cool-down lap, we'll look for the LMP 675 class leader, which will be Warren Carway. Rival we've talked a little bit about here in recent moments, and his teammate Martin O'Connell as Capello salutes the fans and this great crowd that's gathered here at Donington today.
Tremendous crowd.
There is Carway coming around on his final lap to the checkered flag. Front straightaway and a class win. And a flash of the headlights
flash
to salute
the
team.
Yes, they're happy today.
Carway and O'Connell scoring the victory in the LMP 675 class. GTS class winner, the 41 car of Bruno Lambert and Ian McKellar, with McKellar on board as he makes his way down the final corners of Donington Park. Somebody's been off track there, a bunch of turf up on the raceway. So congratulations to McKellar and Lambert on winning the GTS class and the GT. No final pit stop needed for the 23 car. And here they come to the stripe at much reduced pace, looking like to make sure that fuel lasted the distance. And
just
Lucas Lohr and Sascha Mawson win the GT class. Pretty much a mirror dominant performance as the Audi had today. Never really challenged for the win except by their own teammates.
Not at all. For Alex Job, he had a really nice day. When you go out and run your team, have them finish first and second, and bring both cars home with no body damage, it's a perfect way to finish. I was kind of surprised to see that he was going to make the trip over here at the start. But then it made sense. The Audi comes on giving one final little wiggle to showing the horsepower.
So our winners head for the podium and the victory celebrations. We'll talk with all four class winners in just a moment. First, we will take a break and come back to wrap up our coverage here in Donington in just a moment. We'll be back with more of the American Le Mans Series from Donington Park, England. But first, we go to New York and the Sun America Sports Desk. Stay with us.
This is the Sun America NBC Sports Desk. Here's your host, Jimmy Roberts.
Hello again from our New York studio. A quick update on the sports news of the day as we near its close. We start at Fenway Park, where last night we found out in the bottom of the 10th inning that Mariano Rivera is actually human. The Red Sox win on a Manny Ramirez single, and today it was a matchup for the ages. Clemens and Pedro Martinez off to the fens we go. Bottom of the fourth. Bases loaded for Trot Nixon, who goes opposite field on the Clemens pitch. Shea Hillenbrand and Brian Daubach come in to score. Sox up 2-0. Top of the ninth, game tied at 2, and shades of Bucky Dent. Alfonso Soriano gets all of this Pete Sharrock offering, sends it over the monster. Rivera came into the game in the ninth and gets the save. The Yankees win 3-2. The Royals at the Jays. KC had a 4-1 lead heading into the ninth. Now with the score 4-3, Raul Mondesi singles off of Roberto Hernandez, scoring Shannon Stewart, tying the score at 4. Next batter, Carlos Delgado. He hits it into right field. It drops in. That brought in Mondesi with the winning run. Toronto scores 4 in the ninth to win 5-4. Roberto Hernandez has now blown 2 consecutive saves. Into hockey and the first weekend of the Stanley Cup playoffs. The big news this afternoon, Pittsburgh evens its series with Washington just 2 days after being held without a single shot. Mario Lemieux scores the game winner. It was his first shot of the playoffs. And turning to NASCAR, the Winston Cup circuit has tomorrow off, but the Busch Series raced on a new track in Nashville. In his 10th start, rookie Greg Biffle took the lead on lap 187 of 225 and recorded his first career victory. Jason Keller took second, while series leader Kevin Harvick began the day on the pole and finished seventh. Two other significant happenings in the world of sports today, 3 weeks from the Kentucky Derby, and Congaree wins the Wood Memorial over favorite Monarcos by 2.5 lengths. And in golf, an absolutely amazing story. Annika Sorenstam comes from an LPGA record 10 strokes off the lead to win her fourth consecutive event. It's the story of the year in golf, if not for Tiger Woods. And a reminder that coming up tonight, it's the XFL playoffs. The Eastern Conference champion Orlando Rage hosts the San Francisco Demons. Orlando was a perfect 5-0 at home this season. I hope to extend that streak tonight. The XFL playoffs tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern here on NBC. That is all from the sports desk. Back to England for the conclusion of our American Le Mans coverage right after this word.
This has been the Sun America NBC Sports Desk. Sun America, the retirement specialist.
I remember 20 years ago, how did turn the racing world upside down. First by introducing a race car with quattro all-wheel drive, and second by having a woman drive it.
The Pay-Nose Racing School at Road Atlanta, Sebring, and coming to Texas Motor Speedway. 1-888-282-GTRA.
Thursday, an all-new night of must-see TV with a friend so outrageous, so hysterical, it's destined to become a friend's classic.
I tell you, that has never happened before.
Plus, special guest Denise Richards in the first of 5 all-new episodes leading up to the big wedding. Plus, all-new episodes of Weber and all-new Stevie, Will, and Grace.
That is so hot.
And all-new Just Shoot Me. We'll have to explain this. All-new must-see TV, NBC Thursday.
The past, an epic playoff battle that went the distance. The present, a final regular season encounter. And as the playoffs loom large, will a rematch be in their future? The Blazers take on the Lakers to cap an NBA triple header Sunday on NBC.
Back at Donington Park in Castle Donington, England. One of the old, old churches that make up the many spectacular sites in the area to visit. Take a look at our BMW results. Finish order of the race, and you see that it was an Audi day here at Donington Park. with Dindo Capello and Tom Christensen scoring a dominating win, their team car taking second, and the customer Audi taking third position. Let's hear from the race winners with Calvin Fish. Calvin?
Dindo Capello puts the third winner's sticker from Michelin on the car. Dindo, great run out there today.
That was very good, but Tom did a great job in the first two stints. I had just to bring the car home, and the car was very good. I could push, but we don't need it because he had the gap. Tom gain was so big that I had just to bring the car home.
Three in a row, but that win at Sebring could clinch you the Drivers' Championship. You're running with Tom all year long, and that five-point spread will be tough for him to make up when you two are sharing the same car all season long.
Yeah, but for me at the moment, it's the fourth victory in a row. Is, I don't know. I hope that this moment never will finish because it's so nice.
Well, his teammate Tom, you had the Danish flag out there on the wall. Got to be very proud. Great job out there today.
Yeah, I'm proud of everything. The team have worked very well. We had no problem in any of the pre-practices, so we have been on top all weekend. So it's nice to finish it off, and it's. For me personally, it's nice that so many people came from Denmark because it's so near to come and support me. So my son gave me the flag, so I took it on with me.
Awesome job.
Thank you very much.
Capello and Christensen drove separate cars in the Sebring race. Capello won and Christensen finished second, which is why the five-point difference between them. LMP 675 results, great job by the Nissan-powered team. The two local drivers, Carway and O'Connell, who scored the win.
They had a dream come true today when they went in front of the home crowd, and I'm sure they had all of their friends over here. So this just couldn't be a better day for them in such a class that's going to build up to be a great one.
And let's hear from the winning drivers in the 675 class now. Martin Haven is down in victory lane.
Warren Carway, last weekend winning in Barcelona with this car. This weekend, your first win in the European Le Mans Series, and it was a pretty good one.
We can do no wrong this week. Literally last week, win, pole position, win, and my baby daughter was born on Tuesday, so I'm having a good week.
You are having one of the best weeks. The only thing you've got to do for the next race is take the target off the back that only the Audi drivers seem to be able to see.
They can be a bit rough and tumble, but to be honest, as long as we can get them in the straights, they're okay. But it's the Porsche guys that can be a bit dangerous. Two of them nearly had me off, but that's motor racing.
So a baby daughter and two wins in two weekends. Guys, I don't know that there's a better week than that.
Yeah, absolutely. Terrific week for Warren Carway and his partner. And we look now at the GTS class results, the bigger displacement production-based machines, and it was a Saleen day. Now, in all honesty, the Saleens were the only cars entered in that class, but they're going to be tough to handle when they get back to the States and start racing the Corvettes. That's going to be quite a rivalry.
They were so impressive at their win at Sebring because they were against the might of the Chevrolet team. They had both Corvettes running after their dominant Daytona performance, and they blew them away.
We go back to Martin to hear from the GTS class winners from Team Saleen.
Bruno Lambert, your first drive in the Saleen, victory in the GTS class. Tell us, how is the car?
The car is wonderful. I mean, we just got it to the track. It was we didn't have a chance to test before, so we were a little behind as far as pace. But the car is really wonderful. It's great to drive. It handles really well. I think it has a ton of potential, and it was reliable, which is what we needed today.
Ian McKellar, you've been racing with the TVR Speed 12 in the British Championship. How does this car compare?
I think it's night and day. As I'm sitting on the left side was a big thing for me, and changing gear with the right hand was quite a problem. But, after a few laps, you tend to get used to it, and it's not much of a problem.
Looks like you're going to have to rent a left-hand drive hire car before the next race.
Yeah, that's true. I've tried that last week, and we've done a few round of local lanes and bits and pieces. But, no, it's really enjoyable to drive the car. It was really good.
So the Saleen winning first time out in Britain, just two laps before the race.
He's had a tough time in a racing car. I've had a tough time in a rental car, sitting on the right-hand side and shifting with the left hand all week. GT class results now. It is a Porsche romp all day. You see the top six spots, all Porsche GT3Rs. Sascha Mawson and Lucas Lohr taking the top spot. In fact, the top nine spots, all Porsches. The BMWs both suffering their share of problems early and often during the race today. Let's hear from our class winners in GT. Calvin Fish is with the Alex Job Racing drivers, Mawson and Lohr.
Well, the winner today in the GT category is once again Porsche, Sascha Mass and Lucas Lowe, your third win of the year. How does it feel?
Well, this is a special one. I have to thank my crew. They gave me a hard time on the radio because they were calculating every time. We were running on very lean fuel. And I ran out of fuel in my last lap just coming in, and it was perfect calculation. Thank you, Jeff. And, you know, I was very, very nervous. I hope they don't do it to me again. This was too much. I prefer to drive quick, not like this.
The battle with BMW didn't really materialize today, but what do you expect down the road?
I didn't expect it to be a battle without a BMW. They were pretty strong in the practices, but then they hit some troubles. This is a new car. Probably they're going to give us more problems later on.
Alex Job, another 1-2 here today.
And a great job by the Porsche team. There's an old Spitfire.
Isn't that beautiful?
The history of Donington Park dating back some 70 years. It was an old airfield.
That's a great job landing that plane there, too.
Yeah, I'll bet that was tricky. Final results. Overall, it was Capello and Christensen scoring the win for Team Audi. The Audi sweep in the top three spots overall and in the prototype class. There you see the Peugeot-powered Courage chassis finished in fourth position. And the first of the Peugeots was the Privateer Peugeots that came ahead of the two factory cars who both just had miserable weeks here in the East Midlands of England. And the final car in the field was that brand new Dick Barber Racing, LMP 675. They suffered a variety of problems today. Be sure to join NBC Sports Sunday, July 22nd, as our American Le Mans Series coverage continues from Sears Point Raceway in Sonoma, California. And don't forget the XFL playoffs kick off tonight at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Tune in as the Rage battle the Demons for a chance to play in the coveted $1 million game. And tomorrow at noon Eastern, it's an NBA triple header. The Knicks battle the Sixers, then the Jazz versus the Timberwolves. And to top things off, the Blazers and the Lakers, the NBA on NBC tomorrow. For Bill Adam, Martin Haven, and Calvin Fish, I'm Alan Bestwick, thanking you for joining us for our coverage of the American Le Mans Series from Donington Park, England. The Audi team romp the field again with Tom Christensen and Dindo Capello holding the winner's trophy.